We're live. Good morning. Welcome to Better Pickleball. So this morning, pickleball players, I hope you probably don't recognize her because she's cleaned up.
Use your hair up. Oh, wait. Visor. I don't get it down very often here. So like, no.
My name is CJ Johnson, but this is one of the best pickleball players in the country, Laura Fenton Cavanda. She's here. She is giving some clinics. And if you play pickleball, you know that Laura is an amazing player. She is a three-time U.S. Open gold medalist. There's no way you get to that level without being a great player. But what you might not know about Laura is that she is a phenomenal teacher. And that's what we're going to talk about today, is a few things that you can do to improve your pickleball and start playing better pickleball. So, Laura, tell us what made you such a good teacher?
You know, actually, CJ, I've got to go back probably to the first coach that I had. I was 5 years old when I started playing basketball and six at softball. And my coach, John Laird, I grew up in Lincoln, Nebraska, really, really stressed the importance of fundamentals, which I'll talk about a little bit too. Perfect practice makes perfect play. So if we had, you know, a little ball diamond, and we didn't have like fancy things, but a ball diamond, it was like we gave 1,000%, whether it was 15 minutes, 40 minutes, whatever it was. But I think, you know, as a kid, I loved sports. I loved movement. I loved biking, hiking, skiing, whatever it was. So my background with my degrees are in kinesiology, which is the study of human movement. Angles, levers. I teach physics. I taught biomechanics, you know, exercise physiology, sports psychology. I mean, a number of different things. But I think one of the big things why I enjoy teaching so much, whether it was basketball, I coached college basketball and college softball, high school tennis, and I owned a sports academy at one time. So part of, I think, what makes my teaching different is that I have an eye for seeing the basic fundamentals that need to be improved. So for example, if somebody is going to hit a backhand dink or even a ground stroke backhand, well, sometimes there are people who can just feed them balls, but can't correct what it is they're doing wrong, why they're not consistent. And maybe not just what they're doing wrong, but so it doesn't matter if you're a 2-5 level player, I need to see those things that can make them better at that level. I need to be able to take a 4-5 level player, and what is it that's going to make you more consistent? Is it the face of your paddle? Is your elbows are in or this or that? Like when we teach a basketball shot, you know, we teach elbows got to be in. We've got 90 degree angles, our follow through, the snap of the wrist. You know, so little things here and there can make a difference. And I think that's the difference I bring to this game.
And I can tell you, this is not the first time Laura's been here. This is the third time Laura has been in Tahoe. We keep bringing her back time and time again because every time she comes here, people improve. It doesn't matter if they are 2-0 level players. In fact, I saw her give a beginner clinic for the very first time. I mean, people who had, they had no idea how to play, what the rules were, and nothing. I mean, they had, none of them had ever played before. A couple had hit a few shots.
Yeah.
Whether it's a beginner clinic or she's working with more advanced players, she understands the science of movement. So let's get into a little bit. And if you do have some questions, you know, this is our first time live, and so I'm not sure that I've got the chat right. In fact, I kind of doubt that I can see it. But I tell you what, if you do have some questions, you can plug it in because I can see the chat later, and I'll get Laura to answer them later.
Perfect.
Because she's great at email, too. I will tell you that. But so, Laura, let's go into just a couple of things that people can do to improve their game. So when you go teach these clinics, what are the most common mistakes? You know, when I teach skiing, it's like, oh my God, if I see that thing one more time, I'm going to scream.
Sure.
What are the most common mistakes that you see that people can start to correct to become better pickleball players quickly?
Sure. You know, and this is going to depend on whether you're a 2-5 level player or a 4-0 or 4-5, a 5-0. It depends on if you're 20 years old or you're 50 years old or 6 years old or 70 years old. It all depends. But typically, if we take a 2.5 or a 3-0 level player, and maybe they are older, there's probably a really good chance that they're not going to be able to maybe ever put a ball into the kitchen from 38 feet deep in the court. Physiologically, their body may not be able to do that, maybe by mistake, okay? So we have to take them where they're at and say, okay, what is it? Let's just say we have a husband and wife, which occurs often, and they're late 60s, 70 years old. And they've been taught a lot of times, one serves and the ball comes back to one of the partners and the one runs forward because they've been told to run forward. Well, I'm sorry, but 68 years old or 70 years old, you create this huge hole and you can't react. If your partner hits a ball up high, that ball's going to be slammed at the one running up to the net.
I'm sure that's never happened
to
any of us.
Never. Okay? And that one gets slammed at and they can't understand why they didn't return the ball or why their partner hit a bad shot. They think it's a bad shot. Instead, at that level, we take them at what their skills are and say, okay, let's teach you how to come in. Most of the time, there are certain people that some of us all have different motor skill levels and abilities too. Fine motor skills, gross motor skills. Okay. So looking at what they can and can't do, and I'm thinking in terms of Jim and Diane the other day.
Yeah.
Teaching them at 82 years old. These two people were unbelievable. And I'm not just saying that. Unbelievable how they could even move. But they weren't moving together as a team. And just looking at what's on the other side of the net. Where's their forehands or their backhands? And at this point in time, most of the time, our goal is for them just to get the ball back over the net. Okay? But we're looking at where's the right hand or the left hand. We don't say male or female, but we try to figure out what are the weaknesses on the other side of the court, okay? But at the same time, let's work with the two of you in covering the court the best that you can at that level, okay?
I think one of the things that Laura is so phenomenal at, I mean multiple things, but was teaching court position and where to be on the court, how to cover the court. And I know that every time I've taken a clinic with her, I come back and as she said, you just want to scream because you've got somebody that'll hit a shot and run into the kitchen and then boom, it comes right back at their feet or that right. That type of thing. So now let's take that common mistake. We're talking about my game because it is all about okay. Me, right? We were talking about my game. And, you know, 4-0 lever player trying to get better. She picked on my mistakes and not in a bad way, in a very positive way. But what is it that you see at my level that's the most common mistake and the things that we can do to get better?
Well, I think one of the big ones is the patience, not just the patience at the kitchen line, but determining when do I drive the ball. When do I take it right back over the net? What do I do with balls that are right at my feet? And people tend to bend, just pretend this is your upper body, but people tend to bend at the waist, number one, instead of bending at the knees and getting the paddle tilted back and just, as we call it a short hop, but softening even the paddle and swinging from here. Now, her number one problem, her number one problem really was up here. And there's a number of us, and I was guilty of it, because all the sports I used to play were all very aggressive. Racquetball, tennis, football, basketball, all of these things, you're always on the offense. In pickleball, it requires a lot of patience. And this is just a basic key point that we try to get across is when the ball is below the net and you are at that kitchen line, is not the time to drive the ball. And people become impatient. You know, and maybe it's one or two dinks and you see this hole somewhere, or you think you see this hole, but the ball's below the net. And you think, oh, bam, I can hit that hole, and you go wham, and all of a sudden the ball's coming right back at you at your feet, okay? The key of that is you've got to become patient, and that's so easily said, but in keeping the ball in play, and that's why you see as the game goes higher, the skill level goes to the 5-0s, the game becomes much slower, and you could see, we counted one tournament I was commentating on, one match, a finals match, 96 dinks. That's a lot of dinks. Okay?
A lot of dinks.
But if you can really work on your dink game, and you have to be able to get into the dink game, and you have gotten to that point where we've learned that, but getting to that kitchen requires so much patience, after we've become consistent on dinking the balls, now we learn how to read the feet. Do we hit to the outside of the foot of the backhand? Do we hit the weak side on the line? Do we go cross court? Maybe you're playing mixed doubles, and we always tend to think, oh, we have to hit to the girl. Keep it away from the guy. Keep it away from the guy. No, hit behind the guy at an angle or hit behind the guy down the line. Okay? But it requires patience and it requires consistency. Once you've done that, and you're going to find, then they start making the mistakes. You're trying to maneuver your opponents or create the mistake, the pop-up or into the net, then drive the ball. When they bring that ball up a little bit, we want to drive the ball, but not when it's below the net.
Yeah, I did a little bit of patience.
You got better. She did get better. I'll give her credit. She got much better.
But as she said, we play aggressive sports. I grew up skiing and golfing
golf.
And always being aggressive and those types of things. And sometimes you're right. It's absolutely hard to lay off and it's hard to be patient. But definitely, as you get better, and she's right, if you look on YouTube, if you watch the best players, and she's got lots of matches on YouTube, so you can watch her play.
Some of them aren't so good to watch it. We've had some really off days, and we've had some really good days, but, you know, that's, I learned too, you know, and I know mm-hmm. why I had those off days, and it happens to every athlete. And the point is to learn something from every match that you play. Is I know the days why I played bad, and it's like, so let's not let that happen again. And I have a big tournament coming up in August. It's like, I know exactly how I have to prepare for it. You know, that, and learning how to do those things or what you're supposed to do is a big key.
Yeah.
Right there.
Exactly. So now one of the other things that I know we were talking about this earlier that you see a lot of is you're seeing a lot of injury, kind of chronic injuries, mm-hmm. nagging injuries, mm-hmm. that type of thing. So let's talk a little bit about that.
Well, in the teaching field, and you're a teacher too, so you've seen this, like you said, in skiing and golf, all the different sports, in racquetball, many injuries. And I know when I first started playing this game, people say, oh, it's so easy on your body. And I'm out playing on concrete, and you play doubles, you are like planted sometimes. And as we age, we know we have arthritis, but your knees, your back, but the points where people are the parts of your body that people don't think of is where it's taking the most tension. So think about this. How many games do you play where you have a paddle in your hand and you're going bang, 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 because somebody is hitting balls at you the whole time. I've had Scott Moore ripping balls at me time after time after time in a match. Or sometimes if I'm doing a clinic or two or three clinics in a day and we're working this drill, I learned it the hard way because the first time in, 50 plus years, last year, I had tennis elbow and golf elbow. I'd never had that in my life. And I'd played racket sports my whole life. And I'm thinking, what the heck? And learned, it's not what initiates in your elbow. It's your forearm and your wrist flexors. The muscles become so tight. You have 6 wrist flexors here in your forearm. Doing this, everything was tightening up. And I had to go, I went to a chiropractor, didn't adjust anything. He took this metal piece and just dug into my forearms, and there it really looked almost like honeycomb in a paddle, but I had these little marks on my arms, and it was digging up and it was breaking up all the scar tissue in my forearm. So that's one place.
And I'm gonna jump in here and I'm gonna tell you, I've been a golf pro for 28 years. Never had golfer's elbow until I started playing pickleball.
Absolutely. So we're both on the health, and she's on the health and wellness side. And I have been to a certain degree, but this is like your specialty. So we both have been in sports and understand this better now. But I know a big one is in your calves, okay? Which can cause knee issues, can cause heel issues, can cause the ability for that Achilles to tear. And if you're one that happens to play tournaments, plays tournaments, you need to get a roller and roll those calves out or stretch them at least 4 times between those matches because they really tighten up and you're going to have something snap. So we see quads, hamstrings, low backs, but especially we're seeing bottom of feet because you have all the fibrous tissue and all the nerves in the bottom of our feet, but our calves are taking a beating on this concrete and our forearms. Those are the 2 biggest places right now that we're seeing the most injuries.
And one of the things is you can check out some of these videos, and I'll put some up here on a later post, but talking about warming up, how to warm up correctly. And I will tell you, I've taken a multitude of clinics. She's the only one that I've ever taken a clinic with that actually teaches warm up and stretching, because it is that important. And frankly, most of us don't do it. Most people take five swings, hit a couple dinks, run back to the baseline, hit a couple ground strokes, and boom, let's start, right? 0-0-2
Right. And most people, I hate to say, but most people start at the kitchen line to warm up. And I'm sure most all of you do, but you're not getting your legs warmed up, you're not getting your body warmed up, and you need to start back at your baseline. You're not sitting here trying to hit perfect shots. You just need to get your legs moving, get your toe on your toes, get the blood going, and slowly work in to where you're dinking towards the end. But you need to break that sweat. If you don't warm up and stretch first, but you really need to break a sweat first before you really go out and start to play.
So staying healthy, and there's I'll link to some of the videos, because a lot of them on my site are about staying healthy and staying conditioned, because nobody wants to sit on the sideline. In fact, I didn't tell you this. I met a doctor the other day. He'd never heard of pickleball. He said, this is the second time I heard about it in a week, because a gal came in to him and said to him, I tell you what, I play pickleball 5 days a week, and I don't care what you do to me, but it has to involve the fact that I get to play pickleball. And he's like, her ankle was really messed up, so that wasn't happening. But anyway, staying healthy.
Well, it is. And I just want to add to that is, a lot of times, actually, people who play recreationally, like drop-ins, and they'll play 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times a week, really are the ones that are more prone for injuries. Yeah. I see this more often, because a lot of times they haven't played other sports and they don't really know what they should be doing.
Yeah.
You know, the tournament is a whole nother ball game, because you're playing that division in a whole day, one division in the whole day. So to learn how to properly take care of your body throughout the day. But we really see a high number of people with injuries that are your recreational players.
Yeah. So great point. Yeah. So we're covering the court a little bit better. We're being more patient. We're staying healthy. What's the other, like, one big thing that no matter what your skill level, you have to do to improve?
Well, you know, I'm gonna go to a basic for a second, because as you play this game, everybody knows you lose matches by making mistakes, not by ripping winners. Okay, and I'm guilty of this too. If you don't put your serve in the box, and you don't return your serve in the court, or you hit balls in the net, okay? Now we could get into hitting topspin and slice, you know, hitting lookaways, you know, what I call a willy up here at the chest. You know, there's all the fancy shots that you get better and better and better. But if you don't really cover the basics, and I see this in every sport, it doesn't matter if you're watching the NBA Finals, you're watching, you know, the NCAA football championships, and I love football, and I love watching a play develop. But we always say, if we don't execute the basic fundamentals, and sometimes we get away from what it is we're trying to do, and you go into a tournament, or you go into a big event, and you get sidelined mentally, not being able to focus, and a lot of times the coach has to come back and say, let's go back to the basic fundamentals. And how many times you go, okay, or you're having an off day, go, okay, I'm just going to hit the ball in the court. I'm just going to make the other team hit another shot. So I'm just putting my serve in. I'm not trying to do anything fancy, not hitting it hard, no spins. Put it in. I put my next shot, my third shot, across the net. And I keep the ball in play. And it's amazing how many points I win. I go, and I'm not doing anything spectacular here. It's really learning. I mean, that right there. Some days you're really on and you can hit every angle you want, but it really comes down to the basic fundamentals. And if you execute it, it becomes X's and O's, no matter who you're playing.
And the best way to get those basic fundamentals is it...
Practice.
There we go.
Practice.
Which is something, unfortunately, I have to tell you too, I'm guilty of. I mean, playing pickleball is fun. I mean, that's why we're all here, but...
You know, and I said there's been some tournaments I've not played well, and I felt really bad for my partners. For example, when I traveled to a pro stop, and I got in, like, the night before... Totally different ball. I really had not been practicing drilling. I had other things going on, and I didn't play well for my partner. Another one, you know, it does. It comes down to that. It's, you have to practice. You've got to do the drills, but you're going, okay, well, what drills do I do? And how should I do them? What makes me good? And there's drills for two players, there's drills for three players. How can we drill with two people that simulates kind of a doubles game? So that practice and drilling is huge. What you call skills and drills that she created actually last year. I think after I was here in January,
we did it. We started
showing them different types of drills to work on it, where they're the different skill levels were at, and you created that I think two or three times a week. So
yeah. So what we did, and you're going to benefit from our knowledge, you can start a skills and drills clinic. What I did is I borrowed her teaching and her drills, as well as a few other resources. There's a skills and drills checklist. I'm going to put that down inside of the show notes. And also, you're going to find a lot of drills, and with her in them, because we filmed the drills while she's here, you're going to find a lot of drills on this site to be able to help you. And it's super easy to do. You can do it in about an hour. And the best part is it's fun. It's not like you're taking it away from your pickleball. We have a lot of fun while we're doing the drills. Mm-hmm. But the other thing is we also get better, which is what everybody wants.
Well, and that's really the bottom line. If you want to get better, I mean, there's so many things. I'm really, what's the word? I'm extremely analytical and I'm anal. If I really want to be good at a sport, I mean, when I played professional racquetball, I studied the nth degree of that court, the heights, the angles, the speeds, the dead spots, the lighting, the floor, and on a new court especially. One time we played a tournament in Cochabamba, Bolivia at 14,000 feet. So you realized you did not hit a ceiling ball because the ball went walls to walls. You know, but I had to learn where dead spots were, if the ball's going to kick into the sidewall, if it's going to kick out. At that level, it makes a big difference. And I'm kind of that way, becoming more and more with pickleball. That saying, if I'm going to play this game and I really want to be the very best at it, I have really analyzed, I've researched, I've watched YouTubes, but I learn more by analyzing the angles and hitting behind people. And if they're here and if their foot is turned this way or that way, where I hit my next shot, it's kind of like your opponents tell you where to hit the next shot. It's just like basketball. If my defender overplays this side, I can turn my foot here, I get by their hip, I've got them beat. I mean, the defense tells me what to do. So I've become that way now in pickleball as well. I've researched it, I've studied it, I've analyzed it. I love it. Now I love teaching it.
Which means that you need to bring her to your town, because I got to tell you, she really is a wealth of knowledge on all aspects. I mean, she's such a well-rounded teacher. So if you do want to bring Laura to your town, she's got a super busy schedule, but
this summer we're on
her schedule for August. So she's coming back here, so you can always come to Tahoe, because this is not a place that sucks.
It's gorgeous. It's absolutely gorgeous. It's like I'm dying to get out on that lake.
We can make it a vacation, which is what we're going to do. Beautiful. But anyway, if you want to get on some information about her, you can check down in the show notes, contact me. I'll make sure to put you in touch with Laura so that you can find out where she's going to be. She is, as you can tell, she's got a lot in her head, and she can help you no matter what your level happens to be. But there is one other way to get to know Laura. And this, I got to tell you, this sounds, when she called me and she talked to me about this, when she was here in January, she talked to me about this and I was just super excited. It's World Team Pickleball, which is, it's not like anything else that I've heard of inside pickleball. I've seen this in other sports, but I haven't heard of it inside pickleball. It's coming up in December in Arizona. And if you're sitting there saying, what is World Team Pickleball? I'm not going to even try and tell you. I'm going to let Laura tell you what World Team Pickleball is and why you need to be there.
Well, you know, as you said, this is something totally different than any other tournament. You know, when you go to the course to play drop-in and you're with your friends, you play different people, it's fun. And that's really, to me, what any sport is about. Number one, you should have fun. But I find that when you play a sport as a team, with your friends, people in your same state or town or city or whatever, and you come together as a team, you're supporting and encouraging, and you're actually coaching your team as well to get better. So World Team Pickleball Championships, as you said, is in December, first week of December. They are teams of four men and four women, all of the same skill level. And I have it broken down to age divisions too. Your team, the eight people, that team is going to play a minimum of 9 matches against other teams. So let's just say CJ's team is playing my team in the 4-0s. And I'm going to create we're going to play three courts. Excuse me. Three courts. One court is women's doubles. One court is men's doubles. One court is mixed doubles. She has no idea who I'm putting on what courts, and I have no idea who she is putting on the courts. Okay? So my goal is to put the players on the courts that I feel that we can win at least two out of those three courts. I want to win all three because every game, every point, every court could matter when it comes down to the end. Okay, so you're going to be playing teams from all over the country with your friends. The social camaraderie is amazing. I came up with this idea 4 years ago and ran this in Columbus, Ohio, the very first place. And we ran leagues, which we're trying to get off the ground as well. People had a blast. And we went from about 120 people in Columbus, Ohio, to almost 1,900 people playing. People absolutely loved this thing. So also in your matches, though, people can coach between points, whether it's good or bad coaching. But they can coach. And they can yell. It's like, don't do that. Do this. Do that. So you're going to have people yelling at the same time. But there's so many things at this tournament, these extras. The other thing, too, this is a big one. One of my things that I really like is that people know when they play. So your matches will all be scheduled back to back to back. To back, maybe. But you would play all your matches either in the morning one day or in the evening or the afternoon. So you can actually plan to do other things in Arizona in December.
So we got Arizona in December. Lots of pickleball.
Lots of pickleball.
A fun event. She didn't mention, but I will, if you're new to this game and maybe you don't have seven other players who are going to go along with you, you can sign up as an individual and she'll try and put you on a team, but because it is all about meeting other people from all over the country.
Yeah, but there'll be some free clinics. And we have an event planned for everybody who is an entrant. Live entertainment. I'm not going to say it's a band. It's live entertainment that you will enjoy very, very much. And everybody, I will add this one too. Every entrant into the tournament will get a beautiful World Team Pickleball jacket. I mean, it's very, very nice.
So she's got a lot of surprises planned. Yeah. And if you know anything about Laura, not only is she a great pickleball player and a phenomenal teacher, she's just like really fun to hang out with. So if you can't bring her to your town for a clinic this year, you need to, and even if you can, you still need to get to Arizona in December because that just doesn't suck either,
it's
right?
Beautiful.
Let's go to Arizona in early December
and
when
the facility, it's starting to snow. The facility is amazing. Sun City West, unbelievable venue. And I chose that one and actually paying a little more for that one too because there is a kind of a Grand Central Station area that we have. I can't say everything that we're doing with it, but people are going to enjoy hanging out there and socializing with everybody. So, and you don't have to worry about missing your page. So
there you go.
You'll enjoy it.
There you go. So, Laura, where is it that people should go for more information?
WorldTeamPickleball.com. All the information is on there regarding the team and how you register. You will need a captain for your team, and they will have to register first, and then the team members can register underneath that. But it also talks a little bit about the World Team Pickleball Leagues. So if this is something we're wanting to incorporate in every area of the country. So your teams and the official ones will start in January of 2018. But your teams would play in that area against other teams. And there'd be women's team leagues, men's team leagues, mixed team leagues. And we'll do a multi-level team league as well. So you're encouraging your 3-0s, your 4-5s and 5-0s are encouraging your lower level players and they get better that way too because they'll be practicing with them as well. But if that is something that you are interested as well, you'll see that on our website and our email is on there as well.
Great. And I'm also going to take and include that when I post this later. I'm going to take and include that inside of the show notes, a link to World Team Pickleball. And I'll probably put
She's amazing.
It up, like on the video.
She's
like,
amazing. So
around here. But anyway.
What she does.
So as we said, we're in Tahoe and you can tell this is not like Tahoe in the background. We're still sitting in my office and we've got pickleball to play today and we're going to get out on the lake and we are going to go and do some fun things. Thank you so much. Make sure you
thank
tune
you
in
all.
Again because this is not the last time that we'll be doing a YouTube Live. Maybe we can do this quarterly and do this regularly.
Yeah.
Because together we can train smart, live bold, and age well. See you, everybody.